Hi, everybody. It is Jane Rachel, and I'm here today with my third niece. And I call her my third niece because she is best friends of my older niece. And I have been privileged to watch her grow up, I think from the third grade. And she's my niece's best friend. And I watched her grow from this little girl into this beautiful, brilliant, powerful young woman who just got her MBA. So I'm so impressed with her. But today she's here to educate and inspire others based on her own health experience dealing with chronic UTIs. So Monica, just can you tell us a little bit about what you experienced?
Sure. And thanks, Jane. This is really cool that you're doing this project. I'm glad to be a part of it. Sure. So I've gotten UTIs from, you know, a few years after I started having sex. They're always related to having sex for me. That's not true for everybody. But a few years ago, I started getting them very often. Not every time I had sex, but like every other time. And, you know, symptoms for UTIs range for people. But for me, it's just like this really painful, like, feeling in my bladder, which is hard to explain to doctors, because they'll ask you, what are your symptoms? And if you have vague symptoms, they're like, are you sure? And so I would get a lot of like questions about like, are you sure it's like not something else?
I hate that.
I hate that.
It's like, yes, I'm sure. I know what I'm feeling.
Yeah, exactly. Yes. And I think, you know, I really think they do that to women more than men. Yes. So this was like this recurring thing, and I don't know how else should I.
It sounds like it was painful, and not only, you know, two things, like painful, but also probably affecting your relationships. And I find that, you know, chronic health, regardless of if it affects sexual health, just health issues in general affect relationships. So I would imagine this would have had even more of a significant impact with your dating life. And
I would say that there were like the complicating things of the actual physical thing, where there would be a few days before I would actually be able to go to the doctor, get the antibiotic, and it would kick in. That there was like the physical part of it. I was taking off all these random days from work, but also it was really affecting my personal life because it was tied up in sex. And there was like guilt in my relationship, but also myself. Like if I had sex, then I know I might get sick. The person I was with was also like, well, should we have sex? Like, I don't want to keep making you sick. That's like, it's just complicating our relationship.
Yep.
And also, so UTIs, nobody can see that you're sick. So I had this like thing in the back of my head, like, do people think I'm faking it when I keep calling out sick? And there was something else. Oh, the other thing is talking about it is hard because people think, even though UTIs are often related to like sexual activity, they really don't have anything to do with your vagina. Except maybe it's caused by like vaginal bacteria. It's really a bladder infection or some like infection that starts in your urethra. So it seems like you have to talk, like it seems like it's complicated by this like weird thing about sex. And there are people in my life I never told that this was happening to because it seemed too personal. But it also happens to millions and millions of women every year constantly. And
yes,
it happens to people. Once it happens to you, you're more likely to get them again and again.
Yeah.
And the willingness to talk about it was also made this like a difficult thing.
Off the top of my head, I actually know several people who told me, one in particular, that it happened every time that she had sex. So that obviously is going to make all these negative connotations with sex. And then of course, doctors are like, well, is there something psychological going on here? But it's a UTI. There's nothing psychological going on here. And while fortunately this is not a health symptom that I've experienced, it's amazing to me that like the themes are the same. Like, are you sure? Like, what does that even mean with doctors? But when you don't, like it's when you have a broken arm, you know, they know what to do, right? But with many, and also you don't have to worry about whether, you know, people believing you and getting sympathy. So I totally, while not experiencing this particular health issue, I totally get it. You would think that with UTIs that OBGYNs, like that people would at least be familiar with it. And so I'm surprised that you got that kind of reaction from certain doctors.
Yeah. So part of, I think, my story is about just navigating the healthcare system, right? Which I think is, again, like a similar theme
yep.
with the people you've talked to and what you've experienced. I had this high deductible insurance plan, which meant that, you know, the more times I went to the doctor, everything was out of pocket until I spent $3,500, yep. which was a lot of money for me. Yep. So I had been seeing an OBGYN that was, I actually didn't even have a primary care person. And I was like, well, if I go do that, then that'll be more money. So why don't I just bring this up in this visit while I was seeing an OB? And the first thing they did was tell me to take this antibiotic called Macrovid every time I had sex. And I had heard that that's a thing that people have had to do. And I was kind of desperate. So I just took it and didn't yeah. ask a lot of questions, but there was something about that felt wrong. Like I taking an antibiotic, putting my body through that just because I was having sex just didn't seem like the right idea.
Yeah.
What ended up happening was that I after taking it a few times, I found out I was severely allergic to it.
Oh gosh.
That was terrible. Like I got a high fever and I've never had I've never really taken that much medication before. Before that, I was a really healthy person. So I didn't know what was happening, but yeah, I had a high fever and like had trouble breathing and eventually figured it out. So because I couldn't take that anymore, I think if I was fine with that, maybe I would have never gone down this path, which is something I really want people to know. Because if you just are taking Macrovid, you might not be solving the problem. So once I couldn't take that anymore, they were like, okay, maybe you should see a urologist. So again, like instead of sending me to a primary care person, they just sent me to like the next specialist who didn't, that's when I found out why they didn't really believe me because, so one of the things when you have a UTI, they always tell you to do like a urine test and they call it a dipstick or something. They need dipstick.
Yep.
And if you have a presence of, I don't know if they're measuring like blood in your urine or bacteria or something, but whatever is present, then they're just like, yeah, you have it. Here's the antibiotic. But for me, the level of whatever that bacteria was really low. So they kept coming back and saying, well, I don't really think you have UTI. We show like a little bit of this, but that's not usually enough to trigger an illness. So we're not sure. And I was like, I'm in pain. Just give me the freaking antibiotics. All I know is once you give me a Cipro, I feel better in 24 right. hours.
And wait, I got to stop you because I got a whole other video. How like a medication related to Cipro ruined my life for a couple of years. So that's right. Obviously right. it works for some people, but that it's a powerful, powerful antibiotic with crazy side effects. So it's right. definitely not something you want to be taking frequently.
And maybe that's why, you know, doctors yeah. are like, I don't know. I don't want to give you this. On a side note, Jamie, like I was calling Poppy.
And that's my dad. Brittany's my oldest niece. We call his grandfather. So we call him Poppy. That's awesome. Was he helpful at all?
First, I thought he wasn't helpful, but actually the biggest help he told me was to take this thing. It's a painkiller. It's UTI over-the-counter painkiller that you can just get it like where you buy tampons or whatever.
Yeah.
And I had no idea that existed. And that is a lifesaver because it's okay. the difference between like being immobile and being just like completely functional, like nothing's yep. happening to you.
So yeah. I should say Poppy is a doctor, but yeah, not sorry. Necessarily like a retired doctor. So
yeah. Jane's my fake aunt and Poppy's my fake grandmother. So
and we love you. So I'm sorry yeah. you went through all this.
Yeah.
What was the period of time? Like, how long was this going on for?
Like a year and a half.
a year and a half. Okay. And then at some point you got more of an answer, right? What was that answer?
The answer was that, so actually another thing that really ended up helping was I just did go see a primary care physician and said it offhand to her, I'm having this trouble. And she said, I've seen this in a lot of women, like sexually active women. And 9 times out of 10, when they have recurring UTIs, they have this bacteria present in their body called ureaplasma. Let me test you for it. And if you're positive, you're 2 weeks on this other antibiotic and then you're done and it's gone. And then it turns out that I was positive for it. I took the doxycycline and I still get UTIs, just not at nearly at the rate that I used to. So the way that she explained it to me was that, and I've done a little bit of internet research, and my internet research explains it slightly differently. So I think the key is that it's not really clear what's happening, but the way that my doctor explained it to me was that ureaplasma is a bacteria that maybe exists in everyone all the time, but at certain levels, it sits in your bladder. And when other bacteria enters your bladder, it heightens the effect. It heightens the
The chances. So yeah. Just because because they're interacting.
Yeah. The chances of getting an infection. So that would explain why, even if I had like these low levels of the bacteria that causes UTIs, it was like amplifying that effect. And I was getting this thing.
Give me the name again one more time.
Ureaplasma.
Okay. And it just was a simple medication, a different antibiotic, right?
Yeah, a different antibiotic. And the thing is, like, if you Google this, ureaplasma is thought to be the cause of many different things, like not just UTIs, they say. And you can have it in your body and it could do nothing. Like a lot of people have it and it has no effect on you. But it also, they're thinking like, it could be the cause of infertility in people. It could be causing other infections and stuff like that. So it's got such a wide range of possibilities that it's possible that doctors just weren't.
So what was the treatment like? Just a course, like how long? A course of?
It was like 2 weeks on doxycycline, which is, it's not the most fun antibiotic, but and also I wasn't supposed to have sex while I was on it, and ureaplasma is sexually transmitted, so they said your partner also has to take the antibiotic and don't have sex while you're on it, and then you're fine.
And it sounds like it greatly reduced your UTIs. It sounds like such a simple solution, but I'm surprised that your OBGYN, your urologist, no one tested for it, right?
No one even brought it up. And it's not, even though it is like technically an STI, it's not, if you get tested for STIs, they are not going to test for it. It's not part of the like normal
test. Yeah. It's so funny because while this story again is so different from my symptoms, the story is so similar. Like it's just no one bothered, you know, they ran all these autoimmune tests, but because myasthenia gravis is something that's tested by neurologists, not rheumatologists, they never check for that, right? It's just, you know, I wasn't believed, and you're not given a lot of sympathy because people can't see it, right? They don't know that you're in pain. And yet it has a huge impact on your quality of life and your relationships.
Yeah,
it really does. Also interesting is, so my physical therapist who helps me with my back and neck, also her specialty though is women with pelvic floor dysfunction. And she treats patients with chronic UTIs, but more, she frequently says it's frequently from pelvic floor dysfunction. And she says she's helped a lot of people through physical therapy, the pelvic floor area. So I guess my point is there's just a lot of options that I don't think your traditional doctors, you know, if you're going through chronic UTIs, it sounds like you should be getting tested for this. But if that doesn't come up positive, you should maybe also be looking into this type of physical therapy. Cause there's a lot, I guess the point is there are things other than taking Cipro every time that leads to a whole host of other problems.
Yeah. I think there's a lot of different causes. So I think if you explore some options and they don't work out, don't give up. There's there could, it seems like there could be a lot of things that, because it, a lot of different bacteria can cause UTIs. Yeah. And it's also like just the way your body is built. So the reason why women get them so much more than men is because women's urethras are so much shorter. That's the only reason. Yeah. It has nothing to do with anything else. So maybe if your body is shaped differently, you might get more.
Any woman out there who's suffering from chronic UTIs, and again, it's something I do know just off the top of my head, two different women who have that, get tested for this ureaplasma, and also look in other, like, just you've got to do your research basically, and you got to make sure you get to the right doctor. And the answer is probably not taking a heavy duty antibiotic every time you get sick. Any other words of advice for either doctors or patients or anyone going through it? Something similar, Monica?
Well, one, I think for me, the key was talking to a primary care physician who just genuinely cared about me. She was the first person that felt like was really listening to me, rather than just going to a specialist. I mean, not that specialists can't solve problems, but I don't know, sometimes the answer is some more simple, or just someone has to put together all the different things that are going on with your body, not just one. I am the kind of person who talks to people about my problems. So the advice I was getting was from other women who had similar experiences. And it blows my mind how many people are dealing with recurring UTIs. But you can also just, Googling works so much better. So I explained this problem many years later to my current boyfriend, who just Googled something, and there's a new product out there that he was like, why don't you just start trying this thing? It's like a non-medication thing that I drink. It's a drink that I drink after I have sex. And I, knock on wood, haven't gotten any UTIs since I started taking it. So I don't know why I didn't look earlier. It's just occurred to me, but a lot of information out there, and people are go on job on boards and post about their problems, and there's communities, and I'm sure
that. Absolutely. I'm a big fan of those boards. Sometimes they get a little scary because people diagnose themselves and misdiagnose yourself, but if you're smart about it, you can get a sense of like things that can't hurt to try. Like maybe they won't work, but if they're not going to hurt me, right, then maybe I can try them. I think what you said though was so key. I don't necessarily know that it means to be a primary care doctor. The trick is finding a doctor who will listen. And that's hard in this day and age where doctors, with insurance can only spend 10, 15 minutes with you. So it's finding the doctor who will listen to you. And I mean, I finally, after seeing 15 neurologists in New York City, finally found one who spent an hour and a half with me. So it's like, it's just keep going until you find someone who cares. That's one. But also do your own research and go in and be like, yeah, test me for this. So anybody who's got this chronic UTI, do some research, show it to your doctor and be like, I want to be tested for this. And know that you're not alone, and don't let anyone tell you, I mean, they can tell you, but don't believe it when they don't listen to you, right? Then find another doctor. If the doctor is not believing you, because why would a woman make this up, right? Why would we say we have a UTI if we don't? It just doesn't make any sense. And Monica, I really appreciate, because I also think sometimes people are hesitant to talk about things, especially if it's caused by sexual activity, but it's so important, because the more people talk about this, the more women realize that they're not alone and that other people have experienced and that there's possible treatment. So thank you so much. So thank you to my third niece, Monica Rao, who just thank you so much.
Absolutely. This is great.